Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
In this lecture, we will see its application to hydrogen molecule and the simple diatomic molecules. In this lecture, we will see first the setting up of Hamiltonian for hydrogen molecule because it involves four body problem, two nucleus and two electrons. Then we will see the molecular orbital treatment to the hydrogen molecule. We will subsequently see the application of valence bond treatment to hydrogen molecule, then the configurational interaction of molecular orbitals, which is a very important part of this lecture, and then the comparison of molecular orbital theory and valence bond theory. Friends, in this lecture to begin with, we will first need to see the setting up of Hamiltonian for hydrogen molecule. That way it is very interesting. Because this hydrogen molecule is a four body system. Herein you can see in this figure, this is hydrogen atom A, this is hydrogen atom B, and these are the two electrons designated for hydrogen atom A and hydrogen atom B. Let us call that the one electron designated as one is belonging or assigned to the hydrogen atom A, and electron assigned by two is designated to hydrogen atom B. Now, if you look at its geometry, this R1A is the distance between the hydrogen atom A and electron 1. R2B is the distance between the hydrogen atom B and the electron 2. R12 is the distance between two electrons. Capital R is the distance between these two hydrogen atoms, that is internuclear distance, we can say bond length. Likewise, if you see R2A is the distance between this hydrogen atom A and the second electron, and R1B is the distance between hydrogen atom B and the first electron. Now, all these terms are required to set up the Hamiltonian. That way, in quantum mechanics, if one wants to find out how many number of terms the Hamiltonian involves, we can use this formula. That is n plus e into n plus e plus 1 upon 2, where this n indicates the number of nuclei and e indicates the number of electrons. Now, if you substitute these two nuclei and two electron in this formula, you can come to know that the Hamiltonian for hydrogen molecule will comprise of almost 10 terms. Now, if you see this Hamiltonian, herein you can see that this particular bracket, first bracket, will be dealing about the kinetic energy of the particle, which are moving particle in this particular molecule. This capital MA and capital MB are the masses of hydrogen atom A and B respectively, and we have indicated the small m as the mass of electron. Now, these two terms, they are indicating the kinetic energy of nuclei. These two terms, they are indicating the kinetic energy of electrons. And now the remaining terms, they are actually the potential energy terms. Herein, this, if you see this R E square upon R1A is the potential, attractive potential between this positive nucleus and this electron. R2B is the attractive potential between this second hydrogen atom and the second electron, that is hydrogen atom B and the second electron. And therefore, they are indicated with negative sign. Likewise, the negative sign is with this R2A, that is, there is an attractive potential between this hydrogen atom A and the second electron. Likewise, this, there is an attractive potential between this second hydrogen atom and the first electron, that is R1B. And therefore, you will find that there are negative signs. Accordingly, there are positive signs in between the repulsive potentials which are involved, that is E square upon R12 is the repulsive potential which is here between two electrons, that is 1 and 2, and this E square upon R is the repulsive potential which exists between this hydrogen atom A and hydrogen atom B. So thereby there are 10 terms which are involved in this Hamiltonian in detail. Now, if one would like to go for further simplification of this Hamiltonian, we can see the Born-Oppenheimer approximation, and it says that the masses of nuclei are much greater than that of electrons. That means they are almost around 2000 times higher that we have seen. And therefore, their motion can be treated as good as stationary in case of these nuclei. And therefore, in comparison to electrons, these are going to be stationary. And therefore, these terms can be neglected very conveniently. And therefore, the nuclear kinetic energy term is negligibly small in case of nucleus in comparison to electronic term. And then if we try to write down this particular Hamiltonian in terms of atomic units, I can reduce this expression in this form. That is, Hamiltonian is equal to minus half of in bracket this electronic term and then remaining potential energy term. Accordingly, if I utilize this Hamiltonian for noting the constructing the Schrodinger wave equation, it will give like this. That is given by equation number 3, that is Hamiltonian for electronic part, that is psi of dependent part on R1, R2 and capital R. You can see from this figure, this is correct for it, is equal to E psi. So H psi is equal to E psi is now your Schrodinger wave equation, and this Schrodinger wave equation can be solved further, its energy solution can be found out. Now, why we need to set up or see these things? Because unless we set up this Hamiltonian, we cannot go for the solution of the Schrodinger wave equation. Its detailed solutions are available in the literature. However, this Hamiltonian of electronic part is comprising of that way these three parts. That is H cap 1a plus H cap 2b plus this H prime, where this part H cap 1a and H cap 2b are the Hamiltonians of electron 1 in atom A and electron 2 in atom B respectively. That is the respective electrons with their atom itself. And this H prime is the potential energy operator. Now this internuclear distance of separation between the two hydrogen atom, that is capital R, exists in the equation of Hamiltonian as parameter. And therefore the Schrodinger equation of this form, that is equation number 3, has to be solved for each value of internuclear distance r, then plot the energy which we find out against this distance capital R in this fashion. In this figure we have tried to plot it. So if you see, on y axis there is potential energy part and on x axis the internuclear distance is plotted. So this energy that we have plotted or shown in this particular graph, in this particular energy profile, we see that this Re is the equilibrium distance wherein the molecule stabilizes. That means the energy of this particular system is minimum at this particular point. And this particular depth deep of this energy, that is DE, is known as dissociation energy or the binding energy in that sense, which is required to bound the molecule in intact or stable form. Now note that as R tends to zero in this direction, that is from this to this direction, your energy actually tends to infinity. If you look at this, after this equilibrium distance, if we further try to take these two atoms closer and closer and closer further, a situation arises where the repulsion between two nuclei, it goes to such an extent that they separated apart. And now since this nuclear repulsion will become exponentially dominant, the breakage of bond takes place. This orange line indicates the repulsive state actually. And the energy profile is also shown over here. We can compare this energy profile with the different methods. Now we have earlier seen the postulates of valence bond theory. We have actually seen it for the molecular orbital theory. And with this, we can actually compare with the different theories and the proposals what happens to this energy and whether we can approach to the experimental value of this energy. And therefore, that is what we are going to try in this particular lecture, wherein we will try to see the LCMO approximation and the valence bond theory approximation, and we will try to see how they are comparable with each other. Now, this LCMO approach to hydrogen molecule will give an opportunity to set up the wave function, and that too the special wave function elaboration we can analyze with this expression. However, the total wave function, if I try to write down for this particular system, that is hydrogen wherein two nucleus and two electrons are involved, the setting up of Schrodinger wave equation and the setting up of wave function is not that simple, because in this case there are this wave function comprises of two parts, the special part and the spin part. So in hydrogen molecule, the two electron will always occupy the lowest bonding molecular orbital, and that is known as psi plus. This particular bonding orbital, we call it as, for the sake of understanding or for the sake of convenience, we call it as a psi plus, and this is bonding molecular orbital, and we will call this as psi minus, which is antibonding molecular orbital. And in this psi plus state, that is bonding molecular orbital, these two electrons will pair up with the opposite spin. Now the total molecular wave function will include both the special and spin function, and this will be indicated by this equation number 5. Now we know that according to the Pauli exclusion principle, the wave function must be antisymmetric with respect to the exchange of two electrons. This we have seen earlier. Now, therefore, the spin part of this equation number 5 is important. Herein, the spin means the spin of the angular momentum of the electron, and the magnitude of the spin is fixed. In order to have equation 5 as antisymmetric, as a whole, we need to have this as antisymmetric. Now, in order to have this antisymmetric, this special part shall be symmetric. This particular part shall be symmetric. That is, if you look at this equation number 6, this particular part has to be symmetric. If you look here carefully, this first electron is assigned to atom A, and second electron also, if it assigned to atom A, or the another contrast case is both the electrons, if they are assigned to the atom B, that is hydrogen atom B, then the wave function will be ionic in that sense, because both the electrons are either with A or B, or that case must be equivalent to, if it is both the electrons are with A, it will be A minus and B plus, and if both the electrons are with B, it will be A plus and B minus. Whereas if you look this orange part, in which one electron is with A and other electron is with B, and vice versa, so this will be the covalent contribution, because one electron is at a time with the one atom, and therefore one electron is with one atom, and therefore this particular case will be AB type, that is covalent type, which is symmetric. So the quantitative analysis of the energy expression using the wave function gives energy minimum at 31.9 electron volt and 0.74 angstrom. Now this value is very high. So when this energy is subtracted from the total energy of the two isolated atoms, we get the bond energy equivalent to 4.746 electron volt, which is larger than the hydrogen molecule, which we have seen earlier. And this further implies that the bond distance in hydrogen molecule is smaller than that of the hydrogen molecular ion. So this LCMO approach will give you this particular analysis. Now it will be interesting further in this lecture to see how this can be set up. Now there is a justification behind this, and this we will be looking for in the configuration interaction part of this particular lecture. Let us look at the spin part of our equation number 5. Now in the spin part, there are four possible spin contributions. If you say spin half plus half for the first electron, and at the same time the minus half of the second electron. So plus half we will call it as alpha, and minus half we will call it as a beta. So plus half spin and minus half spin. So the parallel spin will indicate that both the electrons will have plus half spin, or both the electrons will have minus half spin, and that state will be the parallel spin state. However, if both the states, like one electron is having parallel spin and other electron is having antiparallel spin or negative half, so this will be antiparallel spin, either with first one is positive and second one is negative, or first one is negative and second one is negative and first one is positive. In all such cases, the spin will be antiparallel. Now, both the electrons, since they are indistinguishable, we can consider this as alpha 1 beta 2 plus minus alpha 2 beta 1. So out of the above, the symmetric combinations will be psi spin will be alpha 1 alpha 2, or psi spin is equal to beta 1 beta 2, or the overall psi spin will be psi spin, if you try to consider, that is 1 upon root 2, which is a normalization constant, into alpha 1 beta 2 plus alpha 2 beta 1, and if we take the another part, is alpha 1 beta 2 minus alpha 2 beta 1. So this will give the antisymmetric wave function in that sense, and which is very important for us. So now, for a two electron system, the complete wave function can be obtained by multiplying orbital wave function with the spin function, such that the complete wave function is antisymmetric. Now, when we interchange the orbital and spin coordinates, and we know that the spin wave function part is symmetric, the only possibility to make the complete wave function antisymmetric is to consider the antisymmetric spin wave function, and that particular part is this, because unless we multiply this antisymmetric part here, the overall wave function cannot be antisymmetric, and therefore we need to consider this as antisymmetric. So if we exchange electron 1 and 2, and if the sign changes, it implies that the function is antisymmetric, and if sign does not changes, it implies that the function is symmetric. So this, your overall wave function will be given by this, and because of this particular part, antisymmetric part, the overall wave function is antisymmetric. And the expression for the singlet set will be, for s is equal to 0, this 2s plus 1 will give you is equal to 1. The spin set will be equal to 1. So the number of spin states associated with any wave function determines the multiplicity of that function. And this multiplicity you can see here, that is 1, where s is the total spin of the state. Now, when the two electrons enter a single molecular orbital, they do so with the paired spins. And spin pairing refers to the way in which electron must arrange themselves in order to pack into the lowest energy orbitals. And this is what is the case here. So what are the properties of bonding and antibonding molecular orbital? So properties of bonding molecular orbital and properties of antibonding molecular orbitals, that way they are interesting to see. So bonding molecular orbitals are formed by addition of overlap of atomic orbitals, whereas the antibonding molecular orbitals are formed by subtracting or subtraction of the overlap of atomic orbitals. This we have seen also pictorially in our last lecture. The highest electron charge density is present at the center of internuclear axis. It means that electron prefers to remain in the overlapping region. Whereas in case of antibonding, at the center of internuclear axis, the electron charge density is minimum. It means that the electron prefers to remain near the nucleus rather than in the overlapping region. Now, in case of bonding, due to electron at the center, there is a greater force of attraction and bond formation is favored. In case of antibonding, the electron is antibonding molecular orbital opposes to formation of bond due to the internuclear repulsion. And lastly, in case of bonding orbital, molecular orbital, due to attractive forces, bonding molecular orbital has lower energy as compared to participating atomic orbital. And in case of antibonding molecular orbitals, due to repulsive forces, antibonding molecular orbital has higher energy compared to participating atomic orbitals. This can be seen, like in this case, you can see they acquire the bonding molecular orbitals. So this is bonding and this is antibonding molecular orbitals. This we have seen in last lecture. Just for the sake of convenience, we have taken it over here. Now, if you try to look for the VBT approach, valence bond theory approach, to hydrogen molecule. So in VBT, we approximate the covalent trial wave function for the hydrogen molecule as this. Psi valence bond is C1 psi A1, that is first electron is with first hydrogen atom, second electron is with second hydrogen atom, and then C2 into second electron is assigned to first hydrogen atom, and the first electron is assigned to second hydrogen atom. And likewise, if we try to analyze this, So this is a covalent kind of situation. This is a covalent kind of situation, and this psi overall will give you C1 psi1 plus C2 psi2, where your psi1 is comprising of this and psi2 is comprising of this particular part. This is as indicated from here, where this C1 and C2 are the coefficient and psi and psi b are the 1s atomic orbitals of two hydrogen atom A and B respectively. Now also that the energy value of hydrogen molecule can be found out with this particular weighted average energy expression. This we have seen from the postulate of quantum mechanics. And if I substitute the values of this particular wave function and giving and taking the help of the overlap integral, exchange integral, and the integrals that we have seen in our last lecture, we get this weighted average energy in this form. And where these particular integrals, that is overlap integral and exchange integral, they give this kind of form. So we have seen in earlier lecture that there were the integrals which we have used, like HAA, HBB, and of the Coulomb integral, then overlap integral, and then exchange integral we have seen. So the overlap integral, using these integrals, we have got the energy of this form, we have got the energy of this form, and then exchange integral will give you this form. The solution of this Q and A is a separate part of this particular mathematical expression, and however it is not covered over here, it can be covered easily that way in a mathematical sense. However, we will not go in this lecture for the analysis of Q and A. However, we will see qualitatively what they mean. So the energy values is obtained by solving the secular equations shown in this pattern. These expressions are obtained from by multiplying this coefficient, these brackets, to the coefficients C1 and C2, and then they these equations, they take the form of secular equations, and they yield the non-trivial solutions, where we mean by non-trivial solution is that C1 and C2 cannot be equivalent to zero, and therefore we equate this determinant equivalent to zero, and the determinant in the above equation is called as the secular determinant. The solution of this secular determinant gives the second order secular equation as an approximation to ground state energy, and which can be solved further. This energy will give you the value of energy, and this energy we have seen in earlier lecture. We have plotted this energy for EG and EU. G stands for G-rayed and U stands for un-G-rayed. So this gives you the bonding and antibonding kind of molecular orbital formation. This we have seen in valence bond approach. We will not go into the details in this lecture, because we have seen this in case of hydrogen molecular ion. However, the energy can be calculated in this fashion after solution, having solution of this Q, A, and then alpha 1 and beta 1, 1, 2. The very important part that one must see here, which gives actually the qualitative explanation to these theories, is the configuration interaction of molecular orbitals. Now, the molecular orbital can be improved, that we have seen earlier in molecular orbital theory as well as in valence bond theory. So these molecular orbital expressions or these molecular orbitals can be improved by the method of configuration interaction. Now, in this method, the wave function is taken as a linear combination of the functions arising from the different electronic configurations. Now, for hydrogen molecule, the possible wave functions are denoted by these. So let us denote these four wave functions, that is psi1, psi2, psi3 and psi4, wherein the psi1 is that way is a combination wherein both the electrons are assigned to the bonding orbital state. So both electrons, they actually are assigned to the ground state of molecular orbital, and which we call it as a psi plus or bonding molecular orbital. And psi2 and psi3 here, if you look here, in both of them, the one electron is assigned to antibonding molecular orbital, and the other to the bonding molecular orbital. And in the psi4 kind of state or character, both the electrons are assigned to antibonding molecular state. Thus, in one configuration interaction, we write the improved wave function by this particular part,
that is equation number 10, where these coefficients C1, C2, C3 and C4 are determined by variation method, wherein we approximate some function and then we can minimize the energy function with respect to these C1, C2, C3 and C4. Then after equating these energy differential of energy with respect to C1, C2, C3 and C4, we get secular equations and then we can solve these. This process we have seen in variation theorem. Now in this equation, particularly that is equation number 10, it can be simplified using symmetry arguments. Now what kind of symmetry arguments we have to do? So only those configurations will mix which have the same symmetry with respect to the exchange of two protons. What I mean by this, we know that the bonding molecular orbital and antibonding molecular orbital are symmetrical and antisymmetrical wave function respectively. So bonding is symmetrical and antibonding is antisymmetrical. The symmetry nature of each of these configurations can be seen in this way. You see, this psi1 is equal to bonding one first electron and bonding second electron, or these two are antisymmetric and this one is symmetrical again. So the function psi1 and psi4 are symmetrical in nature, whereas the psi2 and psi3 are antisymmetrical. Therefore, the configuration psi4 will only mix with the configuration psi1, and hence the equation of this equation number 10 of this form will reduce actually to this equation number 12, because both the parts psi2 and psi3 will go off, because this only part will mix in psi1. Now substituting the expression of psi1 and psi4, we get this equation 13. Substitute psi1 from here and psi4 from here, so we get this equation number 13. So on substituting the LCO expression for this psi1 and psi4, this particular part and this particular part, we get this equation number 14. So after substitution of LCO approximation or expression for bonding molecular orbital and antibonding molecular orbital, we get equation number 14, which on solving will give you this particular part. It is interesting to see here, if you substitute instead of these, see, instead of this you can see psi a1 plus psi b1 and psi a2 plus psi b2 and c4 into, so this for this particular part you can see psi a1 minus psi b1 and psi a2 minus psi b2. If you try to solve this, you will come to result which appears in this form, wherein you can very easily can compare the one part is covalent, wherein the one electron is assigned to one state, that is either bonding or antibonding. And in this ionic part, we have seen earlier also that both the electrons are assigned to either bonding or antibonding part, and therefore this character becomes that way ionic. Whereas if one electron is assigned to one molecular orbital at a time, so this particular part will give you covalent wave function, where this psi covalent is given by this and psi ionic is given by particularly this part. So the interaction between two configurations psi1 and psi4 in equation 12 will produce two refined molecular orbitals with the coefficient C4 having positive and negative values respectively, obviously. From equation 15, this particular part, it thus follows that the contribution of covalent and ionic structure in the refined molecular orbital becomes uneven. That is, in one of the refined molecular orbitals, the contribution of covalent structure will be larger than that of the ionic structure, and it will be more stable than the stable configuration of psi1. In second refined molecular orbital, the contribution of ionic structure will become more and it becomes less stable than the already lesser stable configuration of psi4. So from equation number 15, it follows that molecular orbital theory with configurational interaction is exactly the same as that of valence bond theory, which we have seen earlier, wherein covalent nature was dominating. And with the ionic terms included in it at the same time. So both the method, they approach to each other when one or more of the covalent and the ionic terms are included in the molecular orbital theory. the molecular orbital theory is mathematically much simpler than the valence bond theory, we can say, because the molecular orbital theory can be applied to larger molecule with easily, or we can apply this molecular orbital theory very easily to the larger molecule, and we can very easily take the help of computers for the solution of such kind of states. So based on these particular observations, we can compare the valence bond theory and molecular orbital theory. So localization, in case of valence bond theory, we can say the localization of electrons between the two atoms takes place, whereas in molecular orbital theory, electron distribution over molecules takes place. In valence bond theory, we say that the atomic orbitals of the same atom combines to form the hybridized atomic orbitals, whereas in molecular orbital theory, it involves a linear combination of atomic orbitals, that is the combination of atomic orbitals of different atoms. Now, in case of valence band theory, the resonance plays an important role. In case of molecular orbital theory, resonance does not play any role. Herein, in VBT, the atomic orbitals of the combining atoms retain large amount of their individual character, whereas in molecular orbital theory, the atomic orbitals of combining atoms lose their individual identity in the resulting atomic orbitals, which are completely different. Now, in valence bond theory, it completely fails in explaining the paramagnetic nature of the oxygen, whereas molecular orbital theory could succeed in explaining the paramagnetism in oxygen. Also, according to VBT, H2 hydrogen molecular ion cannot exist, whereas molecular orbital theory can suggest how there is a possibility of existence of hydrogen molecular atom, molecular ion. Now, in valence bond theory, it creates sigma and pi bonds, whereas in case of molecular orbital theory, we see the appearance of bonding and anti-bonding interactions. Now, in valence bond treatment, it accounts for the ionic structure of the In valence bond treatment, it accounts for the ionic structure, and the amount of mixing is determined by variation method. Whereas in molecular orbital treatment, it gives the equal weightage to ionic and covalent character. So all in all, in both the cases, that is valence bond theory and molecular orbital theory, we have seen if we apply the configurational interaction, their approaches become same, almost similar. And if we go on increasing the covalent and ionic terms more and more, their character becomes similar and similar, and thereby we can approach more closer to the actual results what we observe experimentally. We can apply obviously these theories in actual practice to find out the order, or what is the order of energy and what is the bond order. That way we can find out. So one by one we can go on looking for the from the homonuclear diatomic molecule to heteronuclear diatomic molecules, and we can see their electronic configurations. We can see from their electronic configuration the assignment of these electrons to the bonding and antibonding molecular orbitals, their energy level arrangements, and we can also see what are their bond order. We will see all these aspects into the subsequent lecture. Thank you, friends.